Good evening to all of you. It's a very special privilege and honor for me to introduce you to Delphi, to the people who are here for the forum. Let me tell some things about Eleni Sikelianos, and then we'll put the questions. And I believe that she will be very, very better than you can imagine. Anyway, so Eleni Sikelianou is the great-granddaughter of Angelos Sikelianos and of Eva Palmer. She was born in California in 1965. We say your age. You don't have any problem, yes?
Yes.
She is the daughter of John Sikelianos, who is the son, who was the son of Glafkos Sikelianos, who was the son of Angelos and Eva. Eleni Sikelianos is an awarded poet herself. She works in a Brown University, and the Book of John. John is her father. Is one of the most touching books I've ever read. I was reading it, and I was telling, okay, this is. It happens the same thing. When I wrote my book, my novel Phoenix, that comes from the story of Angelos and Eva, my idea was that both Angelos and Eva were more than poets; they were poems themselves. I believe that John Sikelianos, your father, was a poem in motion, and you are a poem as well. So you are more than a family of poets. You are a family of poems. But tell us some things about, first of all, you were born in California, you were born in the States, and you have spent most of your life there. Apart from the trips.
Yes.
Καλησπέρα σας. Είμαι πολύ ευτυχισμένη να είμαι εδώ μαζί σας και ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ that you've invited me. Με συγχωρείτε που δεν μπορώ να σας μιλήσω στα ελληνικά. Δεν τα μιλάω τόσο καλά.
So, you were born...
Born in California, and I lived there until I was about, well, off and on until I was 30, I guess. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I guess half, almost more than half. Yeah.
And when did you, and how did you realize that you come from a very celebrated Greek poet?
It was a little bit mixed because my father John was the lineage, John Sikelianos, and because my father was often missing, he had. Part of the poem of his life was being a drug addict, being somebody who traveled for a long time and didn't make contact with anyone. So there was a bit of a break in the way that family story is passed on. Who I did know very well is Glafkos, the son of Eva and Angelos. And Glafkos had very bitter feelings about Angelos. So I wasn't aware of, I knew that he was a poet, and we had a book of his poems in the house translated into English by Keeley and Sherard, but I wasn't aware of the importance of the history until much later.
Did you have photographs of him?
I didn't, there's a photograph on the selected poems, the very beautiful photograph when he's about 18 years old with the wavy hair. And I guess probably had seen some photographs of Eva also. They didn't belong to me and my mother, but other family members had them.
So it was not a very significant part of your identity as you understood it When you were growing up?
Not so much. Yeah, it was later. In fact, I guess the first time I came to Greece when I was about 20 years old.
Mm-hmm. How did you come in Greece?
How did I come here?
Was it something, you were traveling around Europe and you said, why not going to Greece as well?
It was, I wanted to come to Greece very much, and Glafkos actually encouraged me to come to Greece. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I wanted to make contact with this part of my heritage for sure.
Glafkos was born in Greece in 1909. When he was 7 years old, he was going to the school. They were living in a Corinthia, in a place named Sikia.
Yes. Xylocastro.
Xylocastro. Together with his parents. And one day he quarreled with the teacher.
The teacher beat another student.
The story, because it's interesting.
Maybe you know the story. I think it's somewhat well known, but Glafkos was going to school and the headmaster beat another student for something that Glafkos thought, well, he thought a headmaster should never beat a child. So when he came home, he told Eva, I don't want to go to school where adults beat children. And Eva said, you don't have to go to school. So he did not go to school again.
And he never went to school again. So, Eleni was telling me that this sense of liberty, of freedom, that you don't have to make things, to do things that you don't want to do, is the link that connects the generations of your family. It's the common thing.
A sense of, I think, mental freedom and social freedom, for sure.
Yes, and has a very good, it comes very, very well, and it comes very badly as well, this freedom. Mm-hmm. But tell me something, Glafkos was not talking very much about his father.
No, he was very passionate about Eva, but if you asked him about Angelos, he would say he was a peacock.
What? And he didn't say more things. He didn't care to prove it.
No, not very many more. No. I think it was not a happy relationship.
Son, yes.
Yeah, and some scholars have told me when they read Angelos Sikelianos' letters among many, many pages, say 500 pages of letters, he only mentions one time that he had a child. So I think, there's a lot we could say about that. Does a great artist have to be a great parent? I think being a great artist doesn't exonerate you from being a bad parent. I want to say that.
Mm-hmm. But do you believe that somebody who is a great artist is more difficult to become a good parent?
I think that is a trope that we've accepted, but we don't have to accept it, actually. I think there are a lot of artists who are fabulous parents. Mm-hmm. But I also think that let's think of it in gendered terms. Of course, I'm sure that there are also women who artists who are not great parents, but there hasn't been as much pressure historically on men to be good parents and good artists.
Mm-hmm. Tell me something. He was Glafkos. I remind you that Eleni spent much time with Glafkos. Glafkos was for Eleni a mixture between grandpa and father. But Glafkos was mentioning Eva Palmer.
He did, especially later when scholars started to research Eva's life, which I think, you know, a lot of her history was in the shadows of Angelos. And I think, especially in the 80s, when scholars started to discover or realize that she did most of the work, actually, for the Yurtes Delphikes, he was very proud about that. And also, when scholars started to discover that, in fact, she was, if not a lesbian, at least polyamorous, and she had a very important relationship with Natalie Barney, a woman, and he was actually, Glafkos was very proud about that, too.
Really?
Yes. Yes. So I think that was, I mean, that's part of the legacy of being having a mindset that's not beholden to social norms, right?
Yes, that he was very proud because his mother was a revolutionary.
Yes, and also I think for him it explained some things about his childhood. And I think also that she was a revolutionary, that she felt, Lafkos was, like his parents, believed very much in following your own path, not the path that social construct has set for you.
Was there, in your family, the knowledge that Eva Palmer's father was one of the wealthiest persons in America. That there was a giant fortune. Mm-hmm. Palmer, Eva's father, I cannot recall his name. Eva's father.
Well, her stepfather was Abbe, and her father was Cortland Palmer.
Yes,
yeah.
Cortland.
Yeah.
Eva's father was one of the most a billionaire.
I don't know. There's an amazing new biography that just came out in English by Artemis Leondis, which if you can read in English, I highly recommend it. It's called Eva Palmer Sikelianos, A Life in Ruins, which I think is a wonderful subtitle. It has not yet been translated, but I hope it will be soon. But Artemis says that the Palmers were not as wealthy as it is made out to be. But certainly they did have a lot of money, and Eva, as you may know, spent almost all of it in this city.
Yeah. One thing that it's not a detail, something very significant for me is that Eva didn't only pay for the Delphic gyortes, she did another thing. Which is, I cannot give a title to this. She personally, but she paid for the road to get built that connects Delphi with Itea, and she paid even for the port of Itea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when I was writing my novel Phoenicas, after I wrote it. When my publisher, Anna Pataki, was reading it, she didn't know this detail, which is not a detail. And she read it, and she was astonished, and she said, okay, Eva literally built the road for everybody to follow it.
Yeah.
I believe that it's something that Greece owes Eva, a honor that is not given to her.
Mm.
There's not even a statue of Eva,
mm.
as far as I know.
In Delphi, is there no statue? At the house, yeah. I think a lot of recovery work is being done now to uncover how much Eva did, because it wasn't just, it was important what she did financially, but more important, perhaps, is all the study she did, and a lot of she studied, as you many of you know, the way that cloth draped on in the drawings on pottery and so forth, so that she could make a cloth that would fall like that. So all of her study is so important. But one thing I was thinking about today, knowing that we would be here, is thinking about how part of the study she did was studying the work that was in the shadows in ancient Greece, because it was women's work, right? Who were the weavers? The women. And so that she was going, because, and I, partly we know this now because we know she was very interested in Sappho and what Sappho's life could mean for her life, how she could take from the past a way to inscribe her unconventional life in the present or the future. And so thinking about the way she was bringing women's work to the foreground without saying so, that's what she was doing. And it's now upon us to bring her work forward, because for many years, as we've said, she was overshadowed.
Mm-hmm. Was your grandpa Glafkos telling you, was he talking to you in Greek?
Ποτέ.
Never.
No, I think one time when I came back from Greece, I said, Καλό Χριστούγεννα. And he said, I think he corrected my προφορά.
But was he telling you Greek myths or Greek stories?
No, I mean
fairy tales.
There would be no reason for him to speak to me in Greek because there were no other Greek speakers around. Mm-hmm. He read a lot of poetry actually, and he liked to talk about poetry, and he read a lot of philosophy. What he was actually was a social activist. And he dedicated his life very profoundly at the end to anti-war peace movements, anti-nuclear movements, and he was actually a local hero in my hometown because of his very, very dedicated social justice action. In fact, he was arrested a few times for his protests. And
did he ever run for some...
No, that would not be his style. Yeah, mm-hmm. He would not want to be in office. Imagine, yeah, mm-hmm. He was coming from such an iconoclastic family. But he spent, I think, 6 months in jail. He had a choice. He could stop protesting or go to jail, and he decided to go to jail. And he loved it. He said, I met the most interesting people in jail.
Then now it's John's turn.
Yes.
To talk to us about John, your father.
Yeah. So Christo mentioned that sometimes if you've grown up, one of the ways I think about it is that something that Eva and Angelos passed to Glafkos was this sense of absolute freedom that Glafkos passed on to my father and his brothers. But one thing that happens in absolute freedom is that you, especially that kind of freedom, you're never forced to socialize, and you're to become socialized. You're not forced to learn how to operate in social structures. And so that can be a very liberating thing, but it can also be, for some people, a very difficult thing. And for my father, it was a very difficult thing. It meant that he made choices in his life that that were destructive. He became a heroin addict very early in his life. He was a musician also.
A very special relationship with the animals.
He did.
And with the trees.
Yes, he did. Yeah. So.
Which is extremely, tender.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. I think in that way I see his relationship to Angelos very clearly, a kind of direct communication with non-human life.
Mm-hmm. Eleni writes a story, an episode, that John, her father, was working in the zoo, and he took a small fox in a cage and took it in her place, and the little girl Eleni was playing with the fox, and she continued playing with the fox even when the fox bite her or tried to bite her.
Snap, yeah.
Yes. And another thing, I don't believe it. Her father was taking in a little truck a bear, and he was putting the bear behind on the
next
truck.
To him.
Next
to him, yeah.
Next. And he was driving the bear around the city.
Yeah, around the zoo. Yeah, around the zoo. They were very good friends. He was very good friends with the bear.
So he was a real beatnik. He was living poetically.
Mm, yeah, absolutely.
And about the trees, what was he doing with the trees?
He became what we call a tree surgeon or an arborist, and so that's what he did when he was doing well enough to work. He worked as an arborist, yeah, and so he could tell you. And actually, my brother now works as an arborist, and it's actually one of the things my brother, who inherited a lot from my father, said is whenever he feels ungrounded, he just goes and leans against a tree, and so I've been doing that lately
too.
Yeah, I really recommend it if you're feeling a little bit, because the world is crazy, right? with crazy politicians in charge of things. We're everything feels like it's coming, you know, to this kind of bubble. We're in this incredible environmental mess that we all need to attend to. And so when you're feeling ungrounded, just go lean against a tree and you'll feel, I mean, think about roots. There they are. There's something that can teach us about how to be rooted.
What was your first, when you first came to Greece, how did you find it? How did you like it?
I fell in love right away, in fact, yeah.
In Delphi or elsewhere?
I don't think I came to Delphi that time. I came to Athens and I met Anna Sikelianou, Angelos' second wife. Glafkos had given me her address. And then...
You knocked Anna's door?
I did, yes. I don't think I told her I was coming. I just knocked on her door. And then
you know that Anna lived about... I knew that she lived 102 years. Eleni said that she was hidden some years. And that when she died, she was, as a matter of fact, 107.
Maybe, about that, peripo, yeah. Mm-hmm. Let's see, where I went to, in the Sporadis. And, you know, it's funny because I was sleeping on the beaches and I just had a sleeping bag and I thought it was going to be so warm in Greece that I left my sleeping bag in Athens and it was freezing on the beach at night. Skopelos, that's where we went to Skopelos, and then we went to Crete.
You didn't go to Lefkada? Where?
Not that first time, no. Mm-hmm. But on Crete I bought an anthology of Greek modern poets, mm-hmm. and even though we had the book of my Greek Evangelos at the house, somehow having this book of Greek modern poets, I think by Vironos Raisis, I think, edited it. And there was Empirikos, Sikelianos, Elitis, and others. And that was a very important moment for me, because I always knew that I wanted to be a writer. But in that moment, I realized I could be a poet. So Fine. It happened here in Greece.
You've got a daughter who is 13?
Yes.
Have you talked to her about the Delphike Yorte and the Angelos and Eva?
Yes, she knows a little bit about it because her name is also Eva. She's named for Eva. Mm-hmm. So she has had to learn about it. Yeah. And she's her passion is music.
Mm-hmm. I believe that you should ask now, whatever you like, you want to know.
Yeah, I'd love to hear your questions, but I do want to say one thing, that it's been interesting to be here at an economic festival and to think about economies and to think about, it's easy for us to, the economies of the powerful, who gets to speak and who does not get to speak, and because I think one of the things that that Eva and Angelos and poets are always thinking about is who is silent and how do we attend to who is silent? And then also to think about the kinds of, not just the macro economies, but the micro economies. One of the most important things I saw here in the last 48 hours were a quorum of bees buzzing around an almond tree, around almond flowers, just right over here at the ancient site. And so thinking about that economy, the economy of bees, every almond you have ever eaten in your, every almond you've ever put to your lips was visited by a bee. That's a very important economy to keep in mind. And
you know that bees internationally are in danger now.
Yes, exactly. So that's, and so I'm speaking about them as a kind of synecdoche, as a symbol for this larger thing that we all have to be attending to when we're thinking about economy. Economies are not, poetry is a gift economy. And so how do we attend to these other kinds of economies that we've forgotten about?
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to say that.
Before you ask your questions, I have to mention it's something you can see very, very easily, that Eleni Sikelianou looks like Angelos Sikelianos, doesn't she? Like Eva. You say like Eva. I believe that she looks like Angelos.
Angelos, Eva.
So.
Yeah.
Hello, my name is Despina Bono. I'm a student at URI, the American College of Greece. Today I'm not here as a future economist, I'm actually an actress in a study theater. And I wanted to ask you, from your personal experience and from the things you see now in Athens and in general, would you say that there is room for something correlated to what Angelos and Eva did back then to happen now at Delphi?
I think, well, of course, yes, absolutely. But I think an important thing to remember is it would have to be updated for our times, right? Just as, I mean, I think it's easy to think that Eva was reproducing the past, but she was very aware that she was making something for the present out of pieces of the past. And so how would we do that now? How would we interpret it now? And I think it's actually really important to keep those kinds of utopian goals in mind, even though obviously utopia is no place, as we know, but we have to keep reaching for it. And for me, the arts, that's almost all we have to do that. Yeah. Of course, it would be helpful to have a very wealthy patron, too. Yeah. If there are any in the room, you please step forward. Yeah.
No,
Signomi.
Eleni.
No.
Did you receive the Apollo message or Oracle message that Eva, your daughter, in a short period, she's going to make the opening of the modern Delphi Games?
I think I did receive that message. And I like it. I think it's a good idea. Yeah.
Managed to break away from your heritage, your familial heritage, enough for it not to cloud your own mind when you go about creativity, when you go about writing poetry? Or are you acutely aware of your lineal, direct lineage to Sikelianos?
Had I been born in Greece, it might be a very different story, but I was born in a country who knows almost nothing of Sikelianos, in a language that he did not write in. And so it's not a wait for me. It was a wait for Glafkos, very clearly. I'm sure that's part of why he didn't stay in Greece, even though he stayed until he was well into his 30s, or about, yeah, maybe about 30. He lived in Greece until he was about 30. But I think if I had been born in Greece, I don't know if I would have been able to claim this path, at least not very easily. I think it would have been a heavy weight, for sure. And again, because we can't write poetry in the way that Angelos did, because we're no longer in the beginning of the 20th century. And so it would have been, I think, a wait to figure out how to update that. I have a different family heritage that feels weighty, and that is the self-destructiveness of my father, and also other stories, but my mother as well. So that's a different kind of family weight, but for me it's actually a very it's part of what has made me learn how to look at all angles, or try to look at all angles of a person or a thing, to try to understand these very difficult lives. So that's a different kind of family history.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm Clelia Karisis. I'm journalist, poet. I need to do two questions. I feel very delighted for your experience and to be here. The first question is, if there is a need from the new poetry, a new way of communication, an updated, or a need to communicate with other arts, so as to be more common to the new generation, is a question. This is one question.
Okay, I'll speak to that first. I think poetry always has to be updated, because all arts do, right? Poets have to be of their times. Not what do I want to say, not completely beholden to their times, but aware of their times. And these are very specific times. How do we deal with technology and so forth? I mean, the fact that everybody is constantly like this. In some ways, it's a very difficult time for poetry, because poetry, technology, as we're on our phones and so forth, we are in a very specific present time. And poetry is a thing that's constantly trying to break, trying to bring us out of time. And so anyway, it's something that I think poets always have to be of their time, but also aware of the ways that they break free of their time. In terms of working with other artists, if we look at the roots, the origins of poetry, of course it was danced and sung. We know that, right? So in some ways, that's a beautiful way to go back, what Eva called going back with knowledge. So we can go back and take what we've learned from the past and bring it forward in a new way, right? We reinterpret how we work with other artists. In terms of making poetry popular, I think, I don't know how it is in Greece, but...
Yeah,
Greece.
Difficult.
Yeah.
In Greece, they had a genius idea. The composers of the Greek songs used the poems as lyrics. The Greeks came in touch with Sepheris, Elitis, and the other great poets through the music.
Mm-hmm. And in I the think past, that's, now it's more difficult.
Yeah.
For a new composer to compose lyrics, because there is a new generation of poets here in Greece, and I can say that there are good poets now in Greece, but there is a difficult way between composers and new generation, even now.
Yeah.
And but there is, as you said before, there is a very good, beautiful way to go after, in a very beautiful way to go over.
Yeah.
That's the question is, we have to make the communication between the old generation of poets and the new generation of poets, the past, now, and the future.
Yeah, well, this is a problem. That's something that poets have talked about a lot, that all times are contemporaneous in the mind. I don't know how you would say that in Greek, but the past is always in the present and is always in the future too, right? So, and one thing that poetry does it inhabits all times, potentially. But one thing I want to say is, for me, one of the important things that poetry does is it attempts to articulate what is inarticulable, and that will never be popular in the sense, right? And so part of it is accepting that we always need those art forms that are not going to be popular. And we see it, popular goes very quickly towards populist too, right? So yeah, it's a complicated thing. Yeah, that's. I think there are poets who can write lyrics, and then there are some poets who would never write lyrics. When we get into Bob Dylan getting the Nobel Prize, I think, there are a lot of poets who could have used that prize. He does not need a Nobel Prize, right? That seemed like actually to me that was a signal that the Nobel Committee was on the decline.
The Nobel Committee could give the Nobel Prize to another songwriter poet. I mean, personally, I know how significant Bob Dylan is for the international culture, but I would prefer Leonard Cohen.
Yeah, but see, the thing is, I would prefer it go to a poet who, you know, I think and that goes back to the question of popularity, because there's always that anger. I've never heard of this writer or that poet, and they got the Nobel, but that's exactly the reason those people should get, because they've been working very intensely at an art that people don't necessarily see in popular culture. Plenty of people have seen Bob Dylan. We don't need to be made aware again of his work.
You know, Eleni, that in your great grandfather, era period, era, the poets used to read out loud their poems. Mm-hmm. I mean, Sikelianos, I don't know whether you know it, I was told this by Icarus,
the publisher.
The publisher, yes. Sikelianos used every Good Friday after the church and the epitaph, the Athenians were going to tavernas in order to break the feast. And he was climbing on a table and he was reading out loud, he was saying out loud his poets, his poems, which is something that if you do it now, out of context, not in such an occasion like now this evening here, but if you make it in a taverna, just out of sudden, they would probably mock you. No.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, but now I think that now I remembered that Eva in Athens in 1903 was mocked as well, together with Zadora Duncan.
Yeah.
Because they like to be dressed in this ancient style way.
Yeah. And ethnic forema. Yeah.
She wrote in her memoir. It's a very interesting book. It's in Greece. In Greek is Ieros Panikos.
No, upward panic in English.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that they were in the village of Pagrati. Mm-hmm. Even the term village of Pagrati, το χωριό του Παγκρατίου, it sounds very funny for the Athenians of nowadays because. Pagrati is one of the most populated, highly populated neighborhoods in Athens, and they had a house in Imitos, the mountain, and they walked from Imitos to the center of Athens, downtown, and in the village of Pagrati, they were trying, they were in danger because the villagers. Thought of throwing them stones.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And you probably know that Eva, after I don't know what year, she never wore, or only once she wore Western dress again. My uncle Mark says he remembers being in New York City with her in her robes, and it was a little embarrassing. If you were a child walking around New York City and your yaya is wearing Greek robes and sandals.
And which was this that occasion that she wore?
That she did. Her mother was very upset that she only wore, she felt that it was a kind of an eccentricity that was too far. And so at one, I forget what occasion, when Eva came back to the States, for her mother's sake, she put on Western dress again, one time. Yeah.
And you know that Eva's grave is here in Delphi.
Έχω πάει σήμερα.
Α, πήγες, δεν μου είπες. Δεν μας είπες. So,
yes,
another question, yes.
Yeah.
I would like to introduce myself. I'm Athanasia Psalt, I'm the director of the archaeological site and the museum, etc. Yeah. And you are welcome, Mr. Chomenidis also. I know that he visits very often the archaeological site. And it is a great moment for us today to be here. Angelos Sikelianos and Eva are very popular, and the people here in Delphi love them very much, admire them, and I would like to inform you that Angelos and Eva put, if we can tell them the foundations for the restoration of the archaeological site here in Delphi. The Angelos with his poems and Teva with her work here, they work very, very hard for that.
Yeah.
And that is an issue that people, they spoke about the Delphic Festival, the poems of Angelos, but they don't remember the important view of what became after the Delphic Festival.
Yeah.
And that was the renovation of the archaeological site and the restoration of that.
Thank you so
much. I wrote an article in French about that.
Yeah,
I would like to offer you.
I would love to have it. Thank you.
And, I don't know if there are any questions.
Any more questions?
I actually want to come back to connect Vespina and Clea's question a little bit again, because I think one of the things I want to say is that our cultural institutions also have to invite poetry in, right? So even if we were at the taverna and we got up on the table, we would be mocked. Mm-hmm. But if we're able to do poetry readings in places like this, if we're able to find institutions to support art, again, being enacted on site, I think that's really, really important. Yeah.
A thing that happens in America, as you know, as you probably know, is that the universities, most of the universities, have in-house poets.
Yes, I am one of those.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, in a university, they have understood that to have a poet around the students is something very, very serious and significant. Mm-hmm. Don't know whether this happens in UK as well.
Yep.
It happens, Another thing that happens in UK, I don't know how exactly happens, is that they give the title of the national poet every now and then to one poet. In the UK, not... Mm. Yes. Of course, most of these national poets are not the biggest poets.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
Another question? Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes, of course.
We are very glad to be here, and it is very important your visit and your speech in the museum. So I'm very glad to hear that you love herbs, trees, and this is for us a small gift,
so
an olive from Delphi land.
Thank you so much. That's beautiful. Thank you.
From the whole staff of the museum.
Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ.
In the USA.
Taken in the USA, but can you export it?
Yes.
I'm going to have to hide it in my suitcase. But I'm so... Σήμερα, just today, I was at Eva and Angelos' house, and I thought, I want an olive tree.
Σας ευχαριστούμε πολύ, κύριε Χομενίδη.
Να είστε καλά. Είναι dream comes true αυτό.
Ναι, ακριβώς. Ναι.
Ωραία.
Ευχαριστώ στο Κρίστο.
Ήταν πάρα πολύ ωραία. Να είστε καλά. Να είμαστε όλοι καλά.
Ευχαριστούμε.